Dear friends, I would like to explain to you what is and why is really the synod on synodality, which is taking place during these days 2021 to 2023. The Holy Father, Pope Francis, expects wide participation by all the baptized in the synod. Pope Francis wants everyone to assist him in the preservation and growth of faith and morals, and help him in strengthening the ecclesiastical discipline. The structures of the church must always effectively inspire collegiality and co-responsibility in order to promote a participatory church on the local, that is our SCC and parishes, diocesan, national, continental and universal level, as this has been the clear teaching of the Second Vatican Council. The process for the participatory church must be continuously visible in action. Togetherness, communion, and synodal walking are the key words of the Synod 2021 to 2023. To be participating means to refuse to be mere spectators, onlookers, or passive bystanders in the church only to criticize. The goal of coming together during these days through our SCCs is not to produce some reports for the Pope to write a document. There are no written conclusions of the Synod, no positions of one over the other. The Synod is not an intellectual exercise but a spiritual experience. Therefore, product is not expected but a serious process is recommended. The Synod must begin in every family, moving to SCCs, to parish, to diocese, to national, to continental, and finally to reach the universal level, from where the church will continue to always live synodally. No one is to be excluded, but all are invited to be part of the synod. The church is by nature synodal and must find her nature again, which she lost in the second millennium because of the domination of the clergy, who reduced the laity to the background only to pray, pay, and obey. What is clericalism? It is confusion between clerical service and clerical power. To the question, who is important in the church? Our Holy Father answers, who is important in the church? The one who serves. Priests, religious, bishops will have to open more their ears than their mouths. They must take their seats along with the faithful, not away from the faithful. The synod is a call for structural and procedural change in the church's very being. Pope Francis proposes mainly two images from the Holy Scriptures in order for us to grasp the deeper meaning of the synod. First, Jesus is always found in the Gospels with the crowds, together with apostles. The crowds symbolize the non-chosen, and without Jesus, the crowd is a mere political party. The apostles with Jesus are symbols of inclusive ministries, but without Jesus remain only NGOs. Secondly, conversion of Peter, who is made to deny certain religious traditions in the house of Cornelius when Peter was trying to conserve outdated traditions. In order to reflect deeper on the key aspects of the synod, namely meeting, listening, and discerning during these days of our synod, let me clarify in detail what is expected of us, of each one of us. Number one, let us understand the word synod, which comes from the Greek roots of two words, syn, S-Y-N, which means together, like synergy, synonymous, or synthesis, and hodos, which means walking the way or journeying. From these two roots come the word synod, synodal, and synodality, which means journeying together. On the 50th anniversary of the institution of the synod, Pope Francis said, "Synodality is constitutive dimension of the whole church because it refers to the specific way of living and working, modus vivendi et operandi in Latin. The goal is that the church becomes a synodal reality, like that of the being of the Most Blessed Trinity." Cardinal Swinens, one of the active cardinals who participated in the Second Vatican Council, had said during the Council of Vatican II, "Synodal Church is a kairos of hope, a totality with co-responsibility among all its members." Number two, why is it properly named Synod of Bishops by Paul VI in his motu proprio Apostolica Solitudo, which he published on September 15, 1965, instituting the synod? Why did he call it Synod of Bishops? The bishops' synod cannot be but synod of all the members of the body of Christ, because a portion of God's people, which is entrusted to a bishop to be shepherded by him with the cooperation of the presbytery, constitutes a particular church in which the one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church of Christ is truly present and operative. You will find this in the document of Second Vatican Council, Christus Dominus, paragraph 11. Saint Cyprian of Carthage wrote, "The church is in the bishop, and the bishop is in the church. The bishop is head of the local church and forms together with the faithful inseparable part of the body of Christ, which is also related to wider circles of society. Thus, the definition of the synod has to be broadened in order to include all who in various ways remain in relationship with the mystery of the church. As Catholics, our circle must widen so that the church avoids to exist as a ghetto. That is, all Catholic faithful are fully incorporated in the church. The baptized of other churches or ecclesial communities are joined together to the church. Those of other religions are ordered to the church in specific ways. And finally, those who are seeking God and those who do not know God can also attain everlasting salvation, as noted by Lumen Gentium, paragraphs 14 to 16. Number three, Cardinal Grech, Secretary General of the Secretariat for Synod in the Vatican, gently reminds us bishops that we should play the key role in the whole synodal process. He says, "Obtaining results without maturing a synodal style would consign the church to a disappointment that would compromise the future of synodality and the church itself. It is better for the people of God in our churches to confront the fundamental question rather than to talk about anything at all without structure or direction. What matters is to mature a true synodal mentality, to truly understand that the church is constitutively synodal. That is, the people of God that walks together. Not only because it walks, but because it walks knowing where it is going, towards the fulfillment of the kingdom of God. And therefore, it questions itself about the road to travel, listening to what the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is telling the church. The first and most fundamental fruit of this first stage of the synod process is the conviction, matured in reciprocal listening, that the life of the church begins with listening. A consequence of rediscovering the pneumatological dimension of the church that the council has given back to it to us, and that commits us pastors in particular to the inalienable task of discernment. Consultation of the people of God is an action that falls to the bishop as the principle of principle and foundation of unity in his church. By virtue of his proper, ordinary, and immediate power over the flock entrusted to his care, it is set up to the bishop to open the synodal journey in his church and to accompany that journey so that it may bear the hoped-for fruit. Cardinal Gregg further asks another commitment from every bishop: to be an example in the discernment phase. Help everyone to understand that this is not a job entrusted to someone else, delegated to someone else, but examine the material yourselves. Find a truly collegial way to discern the contributions of the dioceses. May the synthesis you offer to the Secretariat in Rome truly be the fruit of listening to the churches in your respective areas. This act of discernment will help us to understand the collegial nature of the bishops' conferences. In the framework of a church that is constitutively synodal, this is a theme that deserves careful study so that the synodal process can guarantee a true exercise of synodality, collegiality, and primacy. To suppress any one of these aspects is to weaken the entire synodal process. This is what Cardinal Gregg, the Secretary General of the Secretariat in the Vatican, says. Point number four, many tend to think that only a few selected persons represent the whole church. But the church becomes church when she is truly together with all her members. It is not enough to say that no one is excluded. Proactive efforts must be made to make all the faithful an inclusive part of the synod. Therefore, an active and close collaboration of all her members is solicited. Number five, communion. In everyday life, at all levels, from the grassroots SCCs to parish pastoral councils and then to diocesan pastoral council, as well as through other structures like finance and property committees, etc., to the diocese, to the universal church, the entire church is expected to live in communion. How this communion is visibly manifested? How can there be cooperation among all the members? How can the mission of God be promoted and carried out in the world? Such are the questions to be discussed and listened to. All must place these questions before themselves. From each one's point of view, all must search for concrete answers to these questions. Therefore, listening, my dear friends, listening to one another attentively becomes crucial for all the faithful in the church. Sixth, to listen as much as possible to the reality around and to people in society is a very important part of being synodal church. In fact, This is the purpose of the synod we are engaged in. Giving one's opinion without any commitment is not the goal of the synod, but rather listening collectively to the Holy Spirit is the primary goal of the present synod. Let us not soundproof our hearts so that our hearts can listen. Listen to everyone, including children, who may speak through drawings, pictures, paintings, stories, etc., or to youth, as we may need to invent means familiar to our young people in order to listen to them, or listening to the elderly, whose wrinkled faces will speak volumes of experiences. Listening to others is not in order to please the other. It is important to discern what the Holy Spirit is saying to the church, because the Holy Spirit speaks to the church also through one person or a small group when they are closer to truth. Let us not forget that the Holy Spirit speaks to the whole church, and if He speaks to an individual or a group, it is for the edification, that is, building up of the body of Christ. The Holy Spirit always unites. The devil divides. The wise words of Cardinal Oswald Gracious, our Metropolitan Archbishop, will help us. There is a palpable enthusiasm among many about the synodal process, a process that has its own challenges and has to be carefully thought out and effectively guided. Else, the church could emerge from this process more divided and more confused than before. Point 7. The synod should enable us to carefully evaluate the participatory structures already in existence in the church. The SCCs, the Parish Pastoral Council, the Diocesan Pastoral Council, the CRI, Conference of Religious of India, and the Priests' Council are already synodal structures in the church, meant to promote synodal church. They are the fruit of the Second Vatican Council. Synodality is a way to generate an authentic process of involving the whole people of God in the functions of teaching, sanctification, and governance in the light of the classic medieval principle that what affects all must be dealt with and approved by all. St. Cyprian reminds the bishops that in governing, the bishops must do nothing without the advice of the presbyters and the consensus of the people. The laity should participate in the discernment, decision-making, planning, and executing. It is not enough to say the church is not a democracy but communion. That is easily said, unless it clearly means in practice that there is no abuse of clerical authority. Is the clergy confusing power with service? That is the clergy misusing their authority? Clericalism, according to John Dayal, a committed Catholic layman and a skilled social analyst in India, he says, clericalism is the sense of entitlement that the clergy has appropriated to itself so that everything, yes, everything, must be controlled and done in reference to clergy alone. Point number 8. What about divisions in the church? Are there groups of majorities versus minority in the parishes, in the diocese? The danger of democracy is that it easily becomes majoritarianism with no attention to minorities and their voices. The truths of faith are not decided by the majority. One single person or a small group of people may be closer to the truth than all the rest. how to focus all our attention towards common good by setting aside our personal agenda? Can we identify areas of concern in the so-believed today's participatory church? Let us ask if there are any conflicts between what we assume as consultative and deliberative in our present synodal structures in the church. Are we clear when there is a general consensus of the community, and on what basis a church leader would justify a different binding decision than what the community has discerned? It is interesting to read what Pope St. Paul VI stated in Apostolica Solitudo. He said, "Synod of bishops is an advisory body, but it also is empowered so that it also can enjoy power necessary to make decisions." Paragraph 19 of Lumen Gentium notes that Jesus gave apostles certain collective power and responsibilities for the dissemination of the gospel. Point number 9. Our commitment to mission flows from our understanding of the church. The most serious matter is to ask, why does the church exist in the first place? Consequently, every baptized asks, why do I exist? Is the mission of the church to be reduced only to making life comfortable for all on earth? Is not the meaning of the mission of God increasingly becoming ambiguous, the church becoming auto-referential, unclear, and confused today, even for those who believe in the church? How do we Christians called to live in the concrete situation of our country? John Dial again emphatically affirms that numerous reports over the years have lent credibility to the statement that India is probably the worst place in the world for women. So rampant are the crimes against women, especially those who are poor and defenseless. And John Dial further continues, the insidious presence of caste in the Indian church is a homegrown version of racism and is experienced differently in various parts of the country. Like racism, it is often subtle and contemptuous of others not like us in skin, tone, or ethnic origin. Should we not be together in order to listen to one another and to face together common challenges which are before us in our country? If we fail to be attentive to this, we may risk and allow our faith to become weaker. 10th point. Need to change. It is also true that the church is compelled to become synodal in the third millennium because there are rapid changes taking place, especially in the political, social, and economic spheres. Unless the church keeps pace with changes in the world, the church risks of being outdated or irrelevant. The principle of aggiornamento of the Second Vatican Council helps the church of all time. Aggiornamento means to update according to my faith, how to live my same faith but in different situations. That is aggiornamento. If we refuse to change, the change will overtake us and we soon will lose complete credibility. What credibility do we have, one before the other in the church today? And lastly, point 11. Only in the process of listening to one another will we really come to know where the church stands. It is necessary to participate fearlessly in the changing process of the church by meeting, listening, and discerning together. Healthy change can help us give up unnecessary burdens of some outdated, irrelevant, and unnecessary traditions which we have accumulated over the years. Change can help renewal of the church, as the dictum goes, Ecclesia semper reformanda est. Could our present consultative structures be empowered in the spirit of synodality and communion? Cardinal Yves Congar, great theologian of the Second Vatican Council, had said the following about structures of the church: renew what you can and create new ones when it is necessary, so that the church is constantly reformed. Let us ask if we are the one body of Christ that we claim it to be. How come that the body of Christ seems to be divided into groups which manifest a divisive spirit of groupism? Is one group trying to impose itself on another in the church? Is one group trying to compete and defeat in order to prove supremacy of one over the other? Are all the members of the church really active in the church? Unity in diversity is the fundamental identity of the church. But is the church one? The two biggest schisms took place in the 10th, where East and West separation took place, and the 16th, North against South schism took place. Today, perhaps there are no schisms like the 10th century and 16th century taking place in a dramatic way. But is there genuine unity among people in our parishes, dioceses, universal church? The church surely lives on, but some choose to live in different and autonomous groups or in movements which are isolated one from the other. Could the fundamental nature of the church be restituted? Yes, only if all in the church determine to walk synodally. Yet, my dear friends, the synod is not a call for compromise among divided members of the church. It does not seek the least common denominator to simply stay together and coexist. The final goal of the synod is to fully realize that the church is one, holy, Catholic, and apostolic. Thank you for your patient listening.